Random House Audible presents Cyberselfish, a critical romp through the terribly libertarian culture of high tech by Pauline Borsook. Introduction. I live in Santa Cruz, a college and surfer town about 75 miles down the coast from San Francisco, historically known for its boardwalk. Until the resident University of California campus, UCSC, was built there in the 1960s, it was a small town largely settled by farmers and fisherfolks and enjoyed by retirees and vacationers. UCSC changed the tone of the place to that of earth muffin and sunny good vibes. What else could be expected from a school that has as its mascot the banana slug? UCSC's History of Consciousness graduate program, not Mickey Mouse, but as rarefied as you'd think, is highly regarded among humanities geeks. Its pioneering programs in organic gardening and agroecology are world famous, as is its music department with its strength in Javanese gamelan. But in recent years, this nuclear-free, vegan-friendly, lesbian, feminist-sympathetic, New Age-tolerant town has become a southern satellite extension of Silicon Valley. 20 miles through the coastal mountains over nasty, tortuous Highway 17, Santa Cruz is taking on a new identity, that of a bedroom community for one of the greatest and growing concentrations of new money, technology workers, and corporations that the United States and the world has ever seen. Surveying the personal ads in free weekly alternative papers are always a good way to key into what matters locally. For example, in Washington, D.C., GS grades are specified. So it didn't surprise me when, maybe for the 10th time during the 4 years or so since I had moved to Santa Cruz, I saw listed in the personals a particular kind of notice for a man looking for a woman. It didn't say he was buffed or liked walks along the beach or motorcycle trips to Big Sur, or was into caring and sharing, or more mode du jour, that he was dominant but respected limits, or was predominantly attracted to Asian women. Instead, Ayn Rand enthusiast is seeking libertarian-oriented female for great conversation and romance. I am a very bright and attractive high-tech entrepreneur. This juxtaposition of Ayn Rand enthusiasm and high-tech entrepreneurship might seem as random an association as eye color with birth date. For when people think about high-tech, they may not think about politics or culture or the values carried with it. All they may know of high-tech are its advertised appeals, the charisma of Apple Computer and Steve Jobs, the quirky pleasures of web surfing, the scads of instant millionaires it creates, the way email so readily puts grandparents in touch with their grandchildren, or long-lost childhood sweethearts. People who are rightfully glad to be participating in a mailing list for migraine sufferers or to be using laptop computers to work from home most likely haven't thought about the corporations, institutions, and people that have made doing so possible. People not intimate with technology may be thrilled by how holdings in high-tech stocks have enhanced the value of their retirement portfolios, pleased by the ease of online shopping, furniture.com, iDry cleaning, eGravel, concerned that their children may not be web-savvy enough to have a lucrative career as a knowledge worker, bemused when they spot a blimp flying over a sporting event carrying signage for a tire company's website. But high-tech, like any human artifact, is not culturally tasteless, odorless, colorless. It contains attitude, mindset, philosophy. And with geeks, the attitude, mindset, and philosophy is libertarianism in many blossomed efflorescence. The libertarian technology axis has been solidly in place long enough that the phrase, a self-described neo-pagan libertarian who enjoys shooting automatic weapons, required no further explanation when it appeared as part of a technology news feature in an April 1998 issue of the online magazine Salon, a Wall Street Journal front page feature by Gerald Saib in June 1998 described how, by wading into the world of computers, federal trust busters also have waded into the country's foremost hotbed of libertarian political activism. Northern California's high-tech community is a libertarian psychographic hot zone. And this guy's mate quest had to be the real deal. Yet high-tech's dominant libertarian mindset is less well-known than the obvious wealth and new ways of living and working it keeps spinning off and, upon close inspection, is also far less appealing. It's a pervasive Weltanschauung, ranging from the classic 18th century liberal philosophy of that which governs best, governs least, love of laissez-faire free market economics, to social Darwinism, anarcho-capitalism, and beyond. It manifests itself in everything from a rebel outsider posture, common in high tech, I program, I attend raves, and I practice target shooting with the combat shotgun on weekends, to an embarrassing lack of philanthropy, unless it involves the giving away of computers. The techno-libertarian stance can be well thought out or merely a kind of reflexive guild membership. All my geek friends and co-workers think like this, so why not join the fun? Strangers in the Night. My fascination, mongoose to cobra style, with the romance between libertarianism and high-tech has existed for quite a while. I was first startled by what I've come to call techno-libertarianism when I started knocking around high-tech in the early 1980s. In the San Francisco Bay Area, where I have spent most of my adult life, most liberal arts flakes ineluctably end up working with computers because that's where the jobs are. So it was for me back in 1981. A few years out of UC Berkeley with a degree in psycholinguistics, a smattering of acting classes, a lot of waitressing, and a few crabbed, little published poems to my name. Initially, the geek world I was running into seemed peopled with characters very like the familiar Caltech, Jet Propulsion Lab, Southern California aerospace guys I fondly recollected from my childhood in Pasadena. There, the engineers and scientists, more likely than not, shared a vaguely New Deal mentality. They were of a generation that had seen what good things the government could do, from winning World War II to putting a man on the moon. And even if some were strong on anti-communism, conservative rather than liberal, they believed that the government could do great and good things. The unspoken cultural assumption was that progress in our shared civilization was helped along by government programs supporting scientific research, public health, education, and the bringing of electricity and telephony to rural areas. And if quizzed, these technologists would probably have all agreed that there was a shared civilization worth fostering for geek and non-geek, rich and poor. On first inspection, the 1980s and 1990s nerds as people didn't appear that different from the ones I'd known as a kid. But I came to realize that their values, politics, and orientation to the world were very, very different from those of the benign guys in my childhood who, yes, actually had carried slide rules and worn pocket protectors, as no one in high tech actually does now. It took many years of personal observation while I moved from technical writer positions at software firms to staff positions at computer magazines to, starting in 1989, freelance gigs for high-tech corporations and for the glossy, glamorous high-tech style sheet Wired to piece together a picture of an emergent social and political subculture, one that can seem dangerously naive and, at its worst, downright scary. Attending technical conferences and trade shows, getting to know and making friends with computerists, eavesdropping and reading, I was trying to make sense of the libertarianism I found all around. The belief systems I ran into were confusing. For this passionate libertarian population has, for the most part, only experienced good things and not bad from government. And they were disturbing, for beneath them I sensed nastiness, narcissism, and lack of human warmth, qualities that surely don't need to be hardwired into the fields of computing and communications. In light of the peculiar mindset I had been encountering all around, this Lonely Hearts ad in that Santa Cruz alternative weekly did not register as an anomaly. Nor should I have been taken aback, though in the nicest possible way, by the volume of email generated by a humor piece I wrote for www.suck.com, the spy magazine of the worldwide.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.